So just as there are no point instants in the curve, so there are no events in nature. Nature is a constantly fluctuating pattern. You can only designate particular wiggles in a pattern arbitrarily. You can count a convex formation as one wiggle, or a concave formation as one wiggle. Then you decide if you call it one way, if you give the convex properties the title of wiggle, you have to deny it to the concave properties, and vice versa. So when you see that what we call separate events don't exist, it becomes nonsense to speak of one event causing another. What you really mean is that the two events which you speak of as being causally related are simply two parts of the same event. They go with each other in the same way as this with that. The relationship is not causal. It is mutual. And it works two ways in time, because future, so-called future events, are not merely passive to past events. But you could easily see when, for example, any biological process goes on, you can reason just as well from the future to the past as from the past to the future. Why do two mammals have sexual intercourse? Well, it isn't just that they enjoy it. It's also that they're a very complex system which does this because it makes babies. And the prospect of baby works in reverse and creates desire. You can reason that way. Or it's silly. Because the whole process is one. And when we speak humanly and purposively, I am going downtown to buy groceries, then a future event could be said to be the cause of why you're now starting out to get into the car, buying groceries. And the difficulty we have in seeing this to be so is that we think in an either-or way, which is what is called dualism in Hindu-Buddhist thought, and that liberation is being free from dualism. So when you think in an either-or way, you see the figures in the background as moving, and therefore being responsible for their action. But if somebody argues the other way round, say the figures are just following lines of force in a field, gravitational principles say, we're all human beings, you see, we're all concentrated on our fact that we're individually rushing around and doing this and that. But we don't see that we're equally sucked, and that we move around in response to all sorts of stimuli. But neither position is adequate. You have to see that our being sucked by all sorts of stimuli is exactly the same thing as our apparently voluntary and deliberate action. Because what we're looking at is not this Newtonian game of billiards where balls roll because they are hit by cues. What we're involved in is a dance where, for example, watch a snake. When a snake swims, there's nothing more beautiful than watching a snake swim in water. Lovely motion. But you see, it wiggles along, and its wiggle is conceivable, you see, as convex, or was it concave, this way and that way and this way and that way. Now, which side of the snake moves first when it wiggles? So it's very easy to see there. Now, when we interact with the world, what moves first? Who starts it? The objective world or the subjective world? But they are related as this to that. You can't have an object without a subject, or a subject without an object. You can't have something known without the knower. And that gives the show away. There isn't any real distinction between the knower and the known. There's two ways of looking at something, yes. Two poles of a single process. But the knower and the known are subsumed as the knowing. And all life is knowing. Being, becoming. And it isn't something, in other words, that works by the idea of all this happens because someone shoves it. Now you see, the idea all this happens because someone shoves it is basic to Western thinking. There is the Lord God who's the boss. And he sloshes this universe into being and shoves it and sets it going. And you better obey that shove, because he's introduced into it some recalcitrance by giving to human beings what the Hebrews call the Yetzer Hara, the wayward spirit, so that they shall be able to play certain games on their own. Because nothing very interesting would happen if everybody obeyed God. The whole world would be like a lifeless thing, you see? So they had to reason that into it in order to save face for God, practically. Because otherwise he could be blamed for all the catastrophes that happened. Instead of our being able to say to each other, well, it's our fault.
This concludes CD number 1 of Do You Do It or Does It Do You with Alan Watts. Our program continues with CD number 2.